Margo, thank you for meeting with me here and agreeing to do this video interview. And I guess my first question for you is, what have you been up to lately?
Well, obviously, since we're at the conference right now, you know that I've been acting as the senior liaison for the conference committee, so I'm going to breathe a big sigh of relief as this is completed, and I think they did a fabulous job. In my professional work, I've been doing a lot of work with the Mentoring Center of Oakland, where we're working with highly at-risk youth and doing transformative mentoring for young people who are in the California Youth Authority or otherwise in our juvenile justice system, and having a remarkable success rate with reducing recidivism with that population.
Excellent. Are there any books or articles that you've published recently or are working on that you could tell us about?
Well, I did a podcast, which was obviously one of my first experiences with doing something other than what we had done for ISPI. I did one for a person who has a business on communication, and she has been filming thought leaders in certain areas. It was interesting to sit in her small office in front of her computer and do that and see how she did the graphics. And so I guess I am learning more about using technology, because I've always felt that writing is very hard work for me.
Very good. Thank you. Part of the legacy series that we're trying to capture here is some memories or stories from the past of some of our luminaries or people that were important to you in society and in human performance technology.
Well, obviously they go together, and as I recall this morning in the introductory session for the technology and for the conference, that my first conference was 1966, and I had the good fortune on the shuttle van on the way into the hotel to meet Bill Vetterline and Peter Pipe, both of whom became long-time professional colleagues and friends, and I was working for Pacific Telephone at the time, so I hired them to come and work with my staff, as I did Gary Rumler and Karen Breathour and Dale Breathour and Joe Yaney from the Center for Program Learning for Business from Michigan. And the night, first night at the hotel, I met the people who were in the board meeting at that time, and that was Bob Mager and Glenn Valentine and Bob Phillip and Sue Margo. So a lot of the people who have published for our society and our profession, as well as been leaders in the organization. So that really launched me away from business per se, because I had just finished my MBA and obviously wanted to work in the human side of improving business results. And so this enabled me to start really studying more in the behavioral sciences, as well as integrating that with the business results orientation.
Do you have a personal story favorite of, say, Bob Mager that you could share with us? Something from the past?
I think everybody shares stories about Bob Mager, but I think that there are people who have influenced me beyond the scope of maybe even what he did. I think Doug Valentine is one of those people, because he was working for a telephone company also, and so it's a part of the Bell system. And then later with Harry Shoemaker, who's also past president, and Fred Wells, we were all active in what eventually became known as the Bell System's Fair Share Program, where we set standards for every phase of training and performance improvement, from job design and task layout and feedback systems, and proved that if you have, just like our morning speaker said, a common mission, that of improving performance in the workplace, that you can set standards and criteria and have a collaborative or partnership effort, because we had 22 associated companies who were all working toward designing products and resources that other companies would accept and use. And I think that's a model that as yet has been unequaled in the history of industry and organizations.
Who was on your board when you were president?
Well, another favorite of mine who has also left us is Dick Lincoln, because he was the vice president when I was president, and I tried to model for him what I had learned as far as management and leadership, and included him in every single discussion and agreement, including what Tiagi claims is the first performance appraisal that he ever got was from me when I was president, and he was heading up our publications operation. One of my funny stories about Nick is that I just returned from a trip where I was working in Spain, and we had a board meeting in Washington, D.C. at a very nice hotel. And so there was like a presidential suite with a big living room, and then there were bedrooms, three or four off of that. And so the board members had those. And I was looking to find a light switch, and here's this huge apparition coming through the dark, through the living room, and scared me. And then when I finally found the light switch, I found out it was big, tall Nick Lincoln. So, you know, it was a good board to work with some exceptions, some people who were there for their own self-aggrandizement, and that was not easy to work with. Obviously a good learning experience, and I had the pleasure of presiding over the 25th anniversary conference in San Antonio, where we were founded, and someone reminded me yesterday that they had their silver medallion that we had cast for that 25th, and well, we were going to do something like that for the 50th. And I said, with the price of gold, I'm not sure we can step that up for a 50th memento.
Who are some of your other favorite influences from the past for you personally?
For me personally, I think because I have such a strong feeling about feedback, Don Tosti's work, and I know that he and Lloyd Hommy and Jim Evans did the work with Native American populations, a fairly unspoiled culture, to find out what really does reinforce behaviors and cause young kids to repeat the things that you want them to do, and especially around learning. And one of my favorite stories of Don's is that they gave them a menu of activities they could choose when they completed a certain lesson. And one of the activities was to twirl the monitor in his chair, and kids chose that or chose another lesson, even over a sweet or some other kind of treat. So I think I learned a lot about human behavior from that, and contingency management and behavior modification. So two of my workbooks on feedback really are sourced by that kind of research and that kind of work.
The 50th anniversary, as you were just referencing, is coming up here in another several years, 3 years from now, 2012. And I know that you're spearheading our activities regarding celebrating our 50th anniversary. What kinds of things are you hoping to do or see accomplished in that recognition?
Well, I hope to get input from particularly past presidents as to what would they like to see in the way of celebration. I am a team player and believe strongly in collaboration and in diversity of ideas. Two of the things that I've talked with some people about are having a leadership lane that would show photos of our past presidents and maybe just the theme for their year. And another one is to collect artifacts and archives from the past and have that available so that people can see some of the early work that was done. For example, I think Don Tosti has one of the early teaching machines. That was our first attempt to use technology to help people to learn. And I know there's a lot more around that maybe people newer to the profession or newer to the society haven't had the opportunity to see. And there's a videotape of Jim Evans' daughter when they were trying to show her working through this learning program with the machine, and they wanted her to make a mistake so they could demonstrate the branching. And here's this cute little round-faced three-year-old going, she didn't want to make a mistake, and so they could demo the capability of the machine.
Speaking of young people, What do you think the society needs to do to address the needs of our emerging talent, the younger members of our profession?
Well, I think that we've started the channel for them, reaching into the universities where there are programs in improving performance. And the case study competition that's being conducted for this conference, and hopefully will become an annual event, I think will involve a lot more of the emerging talent. I was actually a little surprised yesterday in the mentoring session that a lot of that emerging talent that's coming into this society is really people who have lost jobs recently and are looking for a change of profession or re-entry into a different workforce. So I think we have to choose a term other than young people to describe that. So maybe emerging professionals would be it. I think the thing that they won't get in college, or even unless we really work at it in our profession, is the leadership skills that it will take to perpetuate the organization. They'll get the skills of improving performance and the technology and be able to apply those, but if we really want this society to thrive, then we have to have some way of helping them to also learn and practice and prove themselves with the leadership capability that will carry on not just this society, but in jobs that they take where few people stay in the same kind of technical or professional niche, an accountant, a salesperson, or whatever, because a lot of organizations still reward people by the numbers of people they supervise. So the management and leadership skills are what they will not learn unless we design some process that's effective for passing those on.
I would guess that that might involve mentoring, your specialty area. Could you outline for us the elements of a mentoring program that you might envision for the society to help with these issues?
Well, I think that what we learn through observation or, you know, in training programs misses the tacit knowledge that an experienced and skilled person can pass on. We learn content in all kinds of ways. We don't always learn how to put that content into context. So I think that's what a mentoring strategy could do for developing leadership in the organization. What I would not want to have it be is that one of these emerging professionals be attached at the hip to a single person who is experienced and skilled and become thought of as that person's fair-haired child, because I think that would be more damaging to their opportunities. But have a series of shorter-term mentoring experiences so that they got to see a diversity of leadership style and management style, and also that would expand their networks, because you have a different network guy to some extent than I do. So if someone spent 3 months communicating with you a couple of times a month and they learned your style and got connected with your network, and then they went on to Judy Hale or Roger Addison or someone else, that would give them a breadth of experience that wouldn't happen in a long-term one-to-one.
Thank you, Margot. Is there any other messages that you might like to send to the society at large or anyone else interested in human performance technology?
Well, I really believe that this society, approaching 50 years, has provided the professional home that has enabled so many people with their skills and knowledge and their networks that I want to see it continue as a professional society and become better managed, led by visionaries and with that common mission and with the strategies in place to support it. So that's going to take a lot of work with the current economic situation. My belief is that it's doable when we can communicate and share that mission.
Thank you for your time today, and have a great conference.
Thank you, Glenn.